Hey friends, do you know what Hollywood, NASA, and cancer research all have in common? They all use accelerated storage with a high-performance cache to render their work. And now that capability is available on Azure with the Azure FXT Edge Filer. Ron Hoag is here to tell us how it works today on Azure Friday. Hey folks, I'm Scott Hanselman, and it's another episode of Azure Friday. I'm here with Ron Hoag. You know, this is a little different than I usually see on Azure Friday, because I see racks, I see actual pieces of hardware.
It's certainly different to be doing hardware, yes, when we're talking about Azure, but we're talking about the Azure FXT Edge Filer. So We were part of the Avere acquisition, which just means that we had this hardware and we were acquired by Microsoft and specifically in the Azure environment. So let's talk about what that makes, what that does. It is, first of all, a hardware appliance, like you just mentioned, we're talking about hardware, and it's a clustered file system. So now we're talking, we have multiple hardware items, they're working together as if it's one system. You can see here on the slide, we have three nodes in that clustered file system.
Okay.
And we use this as a read cache for storage. So you think about where's the bottleneck whenever we're talking about any kind of computing, and it's typically the storage. We have the CPU that's running, it's spinning so fast, and it's just waiting on storage. We want to be able to accelerate that storage.
Is the bottleneck at some point the laws of physics itself?
Well, it could be, but most of the time, yes, we're waiting for something, we're waiting for a return to come back from a request. And a lot of times when we thought about the older spinning disks, then that would take some time for us to seek and find that and bring that back. Now that we have SSD, of course, that's a lot faster.
So is it a balance? I mean, like, I understand that like no one wants things on spinning rust because rust tames it takes time to spin up. And then you can put it on an SSD, which has a limit of speed. You can cache everything in memory, except memory is expensive. But I mean, isn't ultimately the goal to keep everything in memory and just have it ready at all times?
It is, and what you'll find out is that the majority, what we try to do is just max out the memory on these devices because that will be the fastest. So we want to have all of our storage available as quickly as possible. So a good section of that in memory, that should be the hottest, the fastest, the most frequently accessed data. And then after that, we'll put SSD for the next tier, the warm tier, for whatever the render farm or whatever it is that's trying to access the data is requesting.
If I'm making my, you know, if I'm making a big competitive cartoon that's going to be like the next big thing and I'm going to render my terabytes and terabytes and terabytes of data, am I thinking about it in the sense of I've got all my animators and then there's just this one giant central disk that we all mount and we have a really, really fast local network? Are we talking about gigabit, 10 gigabit, 100 gigabits, because I want it to feel like a local disk, right?
Sure, and there are a couple of different workflows that you're asking about here. So one is about the animators themselves, and the animators do work with a repository of data, and some of those animators are remote, and if we can put FXTs at their remote sites, then they can access that information quickly as if they're on site, and that's part of your question. The other part is we do have perhaps a repository of data where when we're trying to render the videos themselves, we want to go to the textures and things like that. So if you think about your animation, you might have different, you know, what does the sky look like? And what does the clothing look like? And what about the lights that are coming in? All of those different things have to be stored somewhere. And when you're rendering a video, when you're rendering even just one frame, we need to pull all that together and get that back to our render farm as quickly as possible, or our compute nodes.
I see. And if any one of those assets, any one of those assets in my catalog of assets is not available, then somehow we have to wait.
We have to wait, yes.
Okay, and if I want to open a remote office, you know, maybe I'm in Portland and you're in Seattle, you want it on the edge, and the edge is as close to me as possible?
Correct. It's as close to whatever is consuming the data as possible. So you, if you are an artist, we want to have that data close to you. If you have a render farm that is in Portland, then we want to also have an FXT Edge Filer cluster sitting at your render farm.
Now, I think of Azure Blob Storage as an infinite disk. I mean, ultimately, I just keep throwing stuff at it, and it's attached to my credit card, and as much data as, I mean, it's ultimately infinite. How big are these things?
Okay, well, let's talk about that. Let's go on, perhaps, we'll go over to this slide.
And then we can go back.
And then we can go back. So the two models that we're talking about here, so we're announcing these new models, the FXT 6000 series. Of course, there were series before that. And the FXT 6000 series has two models, the 6600 and the 6400, and that's really what I'm here to talk to you about. The exciting part to me, one of the things that I'm most excited about, is that number of RAM, that amount of RAM. So you talked about wanting to put as much into memory as possible. Here, our flagship product has 1.5 terabytes of RAM in the box, which blows my mind. I don't know if it blows your mind too. My first computer was a Commodore 64 with 64K of memory. So the fact that we're talking about terabytes now is just awesome. So that's our, like I said, our flagship product. And the 6400 has half that, but it's still over 700 gigs of RAM that we're putting in these boxes.
It's funny when you're looking at specs like this and ICs, like for example, on the 6400, it's got 768 gigabytes RAM. Mm-hmm. I'm so used to seeing 768 next to MB.
Right.
And just with the change of one letter,
right,
we're talking about a huge, huge amount of memory, and then right. double that on the 6600.
Right. Yeah, orders of magnitude larger, right. And then on top of that, we were talking about how SSD is fast and we want to be able to use that as much as possible. We're not only just using SSD, but we're using NVMe SSD. So instead of SATA, which is slower, we're using a faster process to use get the SSD data back to us as quickly as mm-hmm. possible. So NVMe SSD.
And I assume that there's a software special sauce as well, because ultimately I'm an animator. I don't want to think about this. This isn't just a giant fast machine. It's got brains.
It does. And yes, the special sauce really is what was built in. That was what was acquired by Microsoft. And that special sauce helps us to identify what the most important data is and put that at the top, right? Make sure that that's available to you as quickly as possible. And you being, again, an artist or a render farm. And then when we were also talking about speeds, of course, we have 6 25 gig or even 10 gig Ethernet ports on top of that, and a couple of 1 gig if we wanted to use something for management, for example.
And see, that network port thing is really interesting to me, because I've been recently retrofitting my house to one gigabit, which really? Makes me feel like, you know, it makes me feel like I have local disks.
Yeah.
But if you're trying to move a terabyte from place to place, it's still a lunch break.
It does take some time, sure, yeah, even over the 1 gig.
So when you've got linked things like this and smarts and jumbo frames and all the different things that you can do to potentially make it feel like it's a local disk, mm-hmm. the animator hopefully does feel like their assets are like right there on their screen.
That's right. And we're talking about animation, but that's not the only use case. So if I can go back, we'll talk about some other use cases like, so we said special effects would be one. So
sure.
animation and special effects kind of go together
right.
to create those frames, those video frames.
Mm-hmm.
But also we're in life sciences, genomic analysis. When we think about our DNA, and not just necessarily our DNA as human DNA, but even plant DNA or bacteria DNA, we can use that DNA and do all types of analysis to find out, hopefully, like we're working toward a cure for cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And so cancer research, as you mentioned in the intro, is somebody or organizations who are using the Avir to or the Azure FXT
mm-hmm.
in order to accelerate that and get that, find that those solutions and test those things as quickly as possible.
And they're all doing that locally. So it is this hybrid solution, which is really interesting. They're not necessarily going up to Azure and back and forth all the time.
Right.
The device is smart enough to cache. It's an edge front end on the blob storage. Is that correct?
Well, yeah. So let's talk about that. So you mentioned blob. More normally, the data is all local.
Mm.
And we're thinking about having our data local in perhaps an Isilon or EMC Isilon or NetApp.
Mm-hmm.
But it could also be we could put data into Blob.
Mm-hmm.
So what we won't do is we won't accelerate anything that's already in Blob, but we will use Blob as a destination for, let's say, Active Archive. So let's say we talk about genomics, or we're talking about the animation.
Okay.
We're going to take things that we might not need immediately, but we could use, like reference information,
right.
put that into Blob.
Ah.
And so you might have lots of videos that you've done. We think about animated videos that have come out, and now they're on version 2, 3, or even 4 of that
right.
video. Maybe they put the first 3 in the cloud, and they could store those in Blob, and then pull down just the assets they need because, oh, we're bringing this character back, and so let's have that available to us as animators.
I think you had mentioned to me this concept beforehand about warm storage versus cold storage.
Mm-hmm.
Is that the idea, that if it's colder storage, then I accept that it's a little bit farther away?
That's right, yes. So the coldest storage would be either, it could be in Blob if that's where you decided to put it, or
mm-hmm.
somewhere on-prem.
Mm-hmm.
So thinking again about your on-prem NAS, your network attached storage.
Mm-hmm.
The hot data would all be on your Azure FXT
mm-hmm.
so that you can get that information to your cluster, your servers, as quickly as possible. Yeah.
So fun stuff like animations,
yep.
important stuff like science,
mm-hmm.
weather simulations, anywhere where you've got hundreds of terabytes or tens of terabytes of data.
Yes, so we're thinking that's exactly right. We could be in front of petabytes of data if we need to, but you're
Seriously.
Correct. We could be, but we're only accelerating tens of terabytes, like you've said. So we're going to cache only the active working set, and that will be inside the cluster itself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's smart, because ultimately you aren't going to be dealing with the entire petabyte or multiple
That's
petabytes
right.
at a time, and you're making all of that as transparent as possible.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and it doesn't matter, yes, where it is. If it's on the Avir itself, that's fine. If it's on-prem, that's fine. If it's in the cloud, that's fine. It shouldn't look any different to the end user.
I love it.
Okay, good. And then simulations is another top use case. So mm-hmm. we think about simulating financial data, financial services. You probably have a 401k and you mm-hmm. somebody might be managing that. And so they're going to run a lot of simulations. They could take that that stock market data, run different simulations against that. We also do simulations for autonomous vehicles. And we think about you know, how does that go down the road and what happens if somebody's walking across or running across or somebody's running a red light. Those simulations, the more simulations you can run through, the faster you can iterate and improve those programs. And then also simulations for genomic types of, geological types of things like oil and gas when they're trying to drill and find out where that oil is and how can they get all of that petroleum out, I guess.
Yeah. It's funny when you think about like the historical context of, you know, someone writes a for loop in the 80s and they can conceive of the combinatorics of the like, well, this is a for loop that kind of describes how I think the tectonic plates ought to work. And I have this question, but I need to run N times M number of, you know, simulations. And you're in the 1980s and you're thinking, well, the cloud doesn't exist. Mm-hmm. I haven't invented it yet. how am I going to do this? It's going to take until the universe's sun death or whatever, you know, the sun death of the solar system. Mm-hmm. And then fast forward 20 or 30 years and we have this amazing amount of technology, not only the power of the cloud, but the power of the edge mm-hmm. with something like an edge filer mm-hmm. to provide just effectively infinite storage that we couldn't even conceive of just a couple of decades before. And I can solve those hard problems where the combinatorics exploded into petabytes of data.
Yeah, and when you're talking about that kind of computation, we're thinking about having, you know, we talked about HPC. Those are thousands or tens of thousands of compute cores that you're going to run against some sort of workload. And mm-hmm. that's what the Azure FXT is really designed for, those high-performance computing workloads. This isn't something where you just want to accelerate something local, home DIRS or anything like that. That's a horrible fit. We're thinking about, yes, high performance computing, just thousands of compute cores working against this. We had one customer who was using the 6600 and was able to sustain 300,000 operations every second for over 24 hours.
Wow.
So this thing is just cranking out as much data as it can in order to support compute.
Yeah, that juxtaposition you made, this is not for your PowerPoint files. This is not a Synology NAS that I pick up at Best Buy.
Right.
This is for serious work.
That's right. So let's talk about a few of these other features. We already mm-hmm. talked about the NVMe SSD, and we talked about that incredible amount of RAM and the network ports. We do support NFS v3, so a lot of people that are using high-performance computing are using NFS for that. Mm-hmm. We also support SMB2. We have a single mount point, and this is one of the features of the product, where if we do have an Isilon and a NetApp, and we have something in Blob up in the cloud. So here's up in the cloud back here. we can make it look as if there's just one storage area that they have to go to, and that's the Avere itself.
Wow.
And the Avere will make all of those disparate systems look as if it's in one storage. And so that's the user experience.
So just to be clear, so mm-hmm. Avere was a company and a product, and then that became acquired, and then now that is now the Azure FXT filer.
Right. This was initially the Avere FXT, and now it's the Azure FXT.
Okay.
That's right.
And I think that single mount point is worth pointing out as well, mm-hmm. because there's a piece of impedance mismatch when an animator or a scientist or someone has to think, okay, where's that data? Right. Ultimately, it's just at slash mount, and mm-hmm. go and have fun. And a petabytes of data at a single mount point is where you
want
things to be.
That's right. And like I said, it could be several different, it could have been something where people had several mount points in the past, or they were mapping different shared drives, and it can all appear as if it's in one area there behind the Azure FXT.
And it's in a clean 1U. I mean, this is a standard thing.
That's it. It's a 1U server. So it's amazing that we could fit all this computing power, all the memory and everything within 1U. So we have the smallest footprint that we could possibly do. Three nodes is a minimum. So that would be it. You know, all of just a few inches in your server room. And we can go up to 24 nodes in a stack.
Wow.
So you can imagine all the terabytes of RAM and or SSD, I guess, and SSD that you'd have available to you for caching. You also mentioned a little bit about Blob, and so I do want to mention here again that we can put things in the cloud. We can move things to Blob if we need to use that for mm-hmm. Active Archive. And with that, we have this sort of bonus, and that is that until June of 2020, or while funds last, customers can get $4,000 in Azure credits, because we know we love Azure and we want everybody to be in the cloud, and they can use that toward whatever they want, any kind of proof of concept.
Wow.
So in a three-node cluster, we're thinking about having $12,000 available to the customer to do whatever they want.
And I have a lot in Azure storage, and that's a lot of storage.
Well, yeah, and it's not just storage. It's Azure credits for anything.
Oh, really?
So it's, yes, it's not. It's not.
So compute or big data or whatever?
Yes, anything they want to use in Azure. Yeah, $12,000. So
that is a heck of a deal.
Yeah, so we say, hey, grab this incredible hardware, use it, and while you're using it, throw some stuff into Blob, and while you're using Azure already to store some things, why don't you test out some workloads and try to do some virtualization in the cloud, try to do some animation in the cloud.
All right. And where can people go and learn about this?
They can go to azure.microsoft.com/services/fxt-edge-filer.
So if you go out and search for FXT Edge Filer, you will be successful.
Yes. And if you could just go to azure.com and search FXT, you'll be able to find it there as well. That'll be the easiest way.
Fantastic. I look forward to my free sample.
Okay. Very good.
Fantastic. I am learning all about the Azure FXT Edge Filer today on Azure Friday.